living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus. I'm living for the world to see. Nobody but Jesus. Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, chase your heart above all else. Make a name, the world remembers. But all an empty world can tell us empty dreams. I got lost in the light when it was up to me. To make a name, the world remembers. Jesus is the only name to remember.
We invite you to attend. We are wearing our masks and staying safe with all of us. So we invite you to join us. And then Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. we have Bible study. Although this week we are canceling because of the Thanksgiving week. We figure people are going to be at home and getting ready for any small gatherings they may have. Maybe they're just with their families, but We know it's a difficult time, and we want you to know that we're here for you if you need need talk or need anything. So I believe that's the extent of the announcements that I have. So we have a unison reading that we're going to read, and then I'm going to ask Brother Jim to come and open us in prayer. I am who the Bible says I am in Christ. I have what the Bible says I have in Christ. I can do what the Bible says I can do in Christ. And by the grace of Almighty God, I will walk by faith and not by sight.
Want to get in the picture here. So welcome everybody. I'm glad to see each and every one of you. I see that the weather has slowed a few people down this morning on attending, but hope to see you here next Sunday. So let's open with a bit of prayer here and welcome God in here. Good morning, God. It's us here at Waterford Baptist Cathedral this morning, and although we're a few in numbers this morning, we know that your presence is always here. We know that you're sitting next to each one of us, giving us guidance in our lives. And Father, I pray that you let us have patience to be able to deal with the virus that is spreading across not only the state, all the states and throughout the world. Father, just give us patience to be able to deal with it. And thank you, Father, for keeping this church virus-free. We have had zero cases in this particular building, and thank you so much for watching over this. And Father, I pray that you be with us this morning as we continue to sing songs of praise to you, and be with our pastor this morning as he delivers the message. And Father, I also pray that you be with our leaders and that are out there. Our governor, may you bless her and give her guidance and her thoughts that she decides what's going on, as well as our president, Donald Trump, and our vice president, Mike Pence, and the decisions that they make that ultimately affect everybody in this world, and also our country. And Father, I pray that you be with us. Let us sit here this morning with an open mind and an attentive heart. We ask all these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Pastor shared with me as he was getting ready for, as he was preparing this week, that his sermon this week was going to be a little shorter than what is normal. Of course, that could still change if the Spirit really grabs a hold of him. But with that in mind, we added a couple extra songs for you this morning. So we now have a package of three songs now, and then Pastor's going to sing a song as well. So feel free to stand if you feel like it and feel up to it, and join us in song. Thank you.
You are amazing, God. give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For a life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. By the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever.
Sometimes it's moments of brokenness which create the greatest transformations. Times where fear gives birth to faith, pain leads to healing, and chaos dissolves into peace. It's in these times we often see God more clearly. For in our deepest turmoil, He remains faithful. When our spirit is crushed, He remains strong. When our moment is too heavy, He carries the burden. As gold is refined by fire, we too are often refined by struggle. It's part of growing, changing, becoming. Lately, the journey has been difficult. Our breath has been labored. Our steps uneasy, but we stand in faith, knowing who is leading us through this desert, the God of peace, the God of hope, the God of restoration.
Well, good morning, everyone. What a joy it is to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Amen?
Amen.
We got a little bit of a reminder this morning of how the precious blood of Jesus Christ washes you and I whiter than snow. And even though none of us might not be ready yet for snow yet, yet it's a great reminder of what the Lord has already accomplished for you and I. We kind of more than sufficiently, I think, wrapped up the book of Nehemiah last week. But one thing that I wanted to kind of capitalize on this week as we are moving into our Thanksgiving week, and of course Thursday being Thanksgiving, was to look at again how that in the presence of our Lord, He wants you and I to be happy. He wants you and I to joyously come before Him and to offer up our praises to Him and make a joyful noise unto Him. And I know a lot of people might say, well, I'm not a very good singer, and you know what? It doesn't really matter. What matters is what's in your heart. And if you're joyous in the Lord, then you can open up your mouth and you can make a joyful noise unto God, whether it's very joyful to a lot of other people or not. Now, I will give credit to the fact that those who are on stage probably ought to at least be able to carry a tune, only because we're leading in worship, you know. And I've struggled at times during my life to actually be able to do that, but the Lord has blessed me throughout my life and allowed me to sing songs that I never thought I would be able to sing, and I would never be able to do it again apart from Him, because without the Lord, we can't do anything anyways, amen? But, you know, last week we were looking at how that Ezra the priest got up, you know, and that he read the Word of God, and that the Word of God that is so powerful, you know, that it convicts us of our sins and convicts us of where we are in our relationship with God, and then it convinces us that Jesus is the answer. And then in the very instantaneous moment, it creates the ability for faith to rise inside of you and I, and allows us then to be changed, to be transformed by that same word that had just a few seconds ago convicted us and convinced us. And so when we allow the word to do what it's supposed to do, even though it brings forth a momentary sorrow, godly sorrow leadeth to repentance, and repentance leadeth to salvation, and then joy can flood our hearts, and then we can be joyous in the presence of the Lord. And that's exactly what Ezra and Nehemiah and all of the Levites were on stage last week as we looked at them standing up there after the walls had been completed and after the gates had been hung, and they were then reintroducing the Word of God to the people so that they would never have to go back to having broken down walls and burned out gates ever again in their life. And so they were to be joyous in the presence of the Lord as they received the Word of God into their hearts. You know, and that's the whole thing right there, is it not? It's all about the reception of the Word of God into our hearts. In fact, the parables that Jesus told later on in the Gospels are all about how that we receive the Word into our hearts. Even in John chapter 6 that we kind of went to a little bit last week about from verses 52 through verse 66, when he made the statement, unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, that you have no life in you. What he was talking about is that you have to receive into yourself the living Word of God, and you have to receive into yourself the benefits that the precious blood of Jesus Christ has provided to you, for you and I, through the cross of Calvary. And if we don't receive that, then we don't get to enjoy the benefits of what He has already done in taking care of the sin question, and also in enabling us through His resurrection life then to live the new and abundant life that He wants for each and every one of us to live. So we're going to look at a one passage of Scripture first, and then maybe the Lord will allow me to sing a song, and maybe He won't. My voice just doesn't do falsetto very well anymore, but I may attempt it anyways just because I love the song, and I know that He put it in my heart to sing it. And so I know if He wants me to sing it, He's going to let me sing it. Amen? Everybody believe in that? That's faith, isn't it? Amen. So, in Psalms 150, and it should be up on the screen for you in just a second, Psalms 150, it says, praise the Lord. Now, that's a very key word, isn't it? Praise the Lord. I mean, what does that even mean? What does praise even look like? What does praise sound like? How do we actually praise the Lord? It says, praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Well, where's the sanctuary at? It's right here. His sanctuary is inside of you and I. We're the temple of God. The scripture says, know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that He has bought you with a price, and you belong to Him? So we're to praise Him in this temple, right? That means that we should be walking around in our homes, and when we're doing our housework, and when we're doing our yard work, and when we're just goofing off and doing silly things, that we ought to be singing to the Lord, whether that's whistling or it's just making some kind of a humming noise in our hearts, because that's what pleases the Lord God Almighty. Amen?
Amen.
And then he goes on to say there that praise Him for His acts of power. The cross are His acts of power. Amen? His deliverance of you and I from the enemies of this world, they are his acts of power. Amen. When he parted the Red Sea, that was an act of power. Amen. And when he allowed them to enter into the promised land, that was an act of power. Amen. And when he allows you and I to stand on the promises of his word, and I want you to think about this for a moment now. Because, you know, there's a song that I love that I can never sing because it's way too high. You raise me up. Anybody know the song, You Raise Me Up? And he says, when you raise me up, when I'm standing on your shoulders. You know, I had my little grandson, we were walking around the yard here just before it got cold. And I had him on my shoulders, and we were walking all around the yard. And I was telling him how much God loves him, and he could reach up and touch the tree branches and stuff. And I said, see, when you're on my shoulders, then you're able to be more than what you are by yourself. And when we stand on the shoulders of the promises of God's word, we become more than we're capable of being apart from his precious promises through which we become partakers of his divine nature. It says to praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Jim, we miss your trumpet. We miss all of these sounds that we used to have up here before all of this COVID hit. Amen. Praise him with the harp and with the lyre. Now, I don't know what kind of an instrument a lyre is, and I don't even know how you would play that, but I'm sure that some musician does, but I do know what a harp is. Praise him with the tambourine, and then praise him with dancing. How long have we in the church kind of outlawed dancing? And then here, his word says, we ought to be dancing in the aisles for joy before the presence of the Lord. Remember when young David danced before the Lord in his undergarments, and his wife looked out the window and she despised him for doing so, right? And then the Lord stricken her womb and wouldn't allow her to give children because she had despised her husband for celebrating God in the way that he had chosen to celebrate him. And we need to remember that celebration is a celebration no matter what it looks like, amen? Praise him with the strings and with the flute, that means guitars and every other kind of stringed instrument. Praise him with the clash of the cymbals. Praise him with the resounding cymbals. And I'm not for sure what the difference between a clash of cymbals and resounding cymbals is, but probably those that use cymbals to make music, they probably know what that actually means, right? But here's the thing. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. I'm going to ask you a simple question, whether you're here in person or whether you're watching online. Do you have breath? Do you have any breath in your lungs? Are you still alive? I mean, you're not just walking dead, are you? You're all alive, right? You got breath in your lungs? Then the Bible says that let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Amen? I want to try to sing a song for you now, if the Lord be so gracious to allow me to attempt this. And you probably have heard it. It's called Do It Again, and it's made by Elevation Worship. And pray that I can do some falsetto for a little bit here.
You want the lower or the medium?
No, just the music.
Which track?
Lower
or
the
low.
Medium?
Yeah, let's go low. I tried the medium earlier and I couldn't get it.
I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. And waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. Oh, you have never failed me yet.
Listen.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. And this is my confidence.
You've never failed me yet.
Isn't that so true?
I know the night won't last, 'cause your word will come to pass, and my heart will sing your praise again. And Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love, oh, my heart will sing your praise again. Oh, yes it will. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence, you've never failed. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you've never failed me yet. Never failed me yet. Oh, you never failed. Your love never fails, Lord. You never failed. Oh. You move the mountains, and I believe, I see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe, I see you do it again. I see you move the mountains, and I believe, I see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, and I believe, I see you do it again. I see you move the mountains, and I believe, I see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. I believe, I see you do it again. Oh, you'll keep doing it over and over again. Oh, Lord, you never fail. Moving here today. Faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is our confidence. You've never failed us yet. You've never failed us yet. And we never will forget. You've never failed us yet. And we never will forget.
never forget your love, O Lord. Never forget your mercy and your grace, O Lord.
Amen. What about you? Will you ever forget? Will you ever forget what God has already done? Will you ever forget what He's already promised that He's still going to do? We can bank on those promises because God never, ever, ever fails. Heaven and earth will pass away, but God's word will endure forever, and His word can never fail. And because Jesus is the Word who became flesh, Jesus will never fail. And so that means that we never have to worry that the world's going to win or that the world's getting the upper hand, because God never fails. He's going to come through. Just as He came through for the children of Israel and kept His promise that He promised all the way back in the book of Isaiah. He promised over 100 years before it ever happened that Cyrus would be the one who would conquer the Babylonian Empire. And that Cyrus then would set his people free, and Cyrus would allow them to go back to the land and to rebuild the temple of God. And it happened exactly the way his word said it would happen. And then later on, another 70 years after that, then he also allowed Nehemiah, who was a type of the Holy Spirit, to go back and to then partner with the people to rebuild the walls of their lives and to rehang the gates of their authority so that they could live the abundant life that God always wanted the children of Israel to live. He kept his promise. And I want to wrap this up today by showing us how God is still going to keep His promise from those same passages of Scripture here this morning. So first of all, I want to look at Isaiah chapter 42. And I'm just going to slide these over because I got some notes here and some over here. All right? So if we look at Isaiah chapter 42... he says, I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand, and I will keep you, and will make you to be a covenant for the people, and a light for the Gentiles. Now, who's he talking about? He's talking about Jesus Christ, the Messiah, right? He's talking about the coming Messiah, and that through the coming Messiah, that he's going to take us all by the hand, and he's going to lead us all out, right? He says, I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness, right? That you should be a covenant for the people, and that you should be a light for the Gentiles. He's the light of the world, folks. Darkness doesn't stand a chance against the light of the world. When the light shines, darkness flees. Amen? Our vision, we don't have to worry about that it's going to be completed, because God Himself is going to complete it. It's His vision. It's not our vision. It's His vision of how the light is eventually going to eradicate the darkness. And the darkness is going to be gone forever. Right? And He's challenged you and I to take that into our communities, to take it into our lives, and to go out into our everyday world, and to let the light shine through you and I, and watch darkness flee, because light always makes the darkness flee. So just be light. You're children of the light. You're children of the day. You are no longer of the darkness. And so we can't be overtaken by it, because darkness can't overtake light. It's always the opposite. Light always overtakes the darkness. Amen? So in that very couple of passages of Scripture, think about that for a moment. God's light is for all nations. And no longer will people have to stumble through the life in darkness, wondering which way to go or how to handle their problems or the hardships of life. No longer will people have to wonder where that they came from or why they're here or even where they are going. God promises through the Messiah, says that He will eliminate all darkness from the face of the earth. All of that darkness right now keeps us all in the dark, not knowing what's going to happen, not knowing what tomorrow's going to bring, not knowing what the world's going to do in the midst of all of this COVID, or even with the change of the presidency or anything else. Guess what? It doesn't matter. It makes absolutely no difference. It matters not. Because God's agenda is marching forth. He's taking care of the darkness with the light, and he's going to eradicate it all forever. All darkness of ignorance, all purposelessness, emptiness, all loneliness, all the darkness of restlessness, all anger, all hostility, all discrimination, all prejudice, and all warfare. All things of the darkness are going to be eradicated forever. Isn't that good news? Isn't that something to rejoice about? Isn't that something to celebrate? That God's promise to eradicate the darkness is going to come true, and it is coming true more and more each and every day. God's servant, Jesus Christ, was sent forth as the light of the world in order to lead the world back into the light of the presence of God the Father. He would give his life as a sacrifice for the sins of the whole world, and then through that resurrected life, he would be a light that would lead us all out of the darkness of all of these things and back into the light of our purpose for being here and for his desires and his will to be brought forth in your life and in my life. In Matthew 4:16, it says that the people which sat in darkness saw a great light, and to them which sat in the region and in the shadow of death, light sprung up. You remember back for a moment this morning? Remember back to the time? Remember back to the time when the light sprung forth in your life? You remember when you finally knew that you were lost, and you finally knew that the Lord was the only one who could save you, and you ask him to come into your heart, be your Savior and Lord, how immediately it seemed like the lights went on and darkness inside of you began to flee. And you were overjoyed and filled with the joy of his salvation. And then guess what? With a little passage of time, you know, we go 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years down the road, and we somehow seem to forget the joy of that salvation. We forget about the initial entrance of that light because in many ways we've given the darkness quarter and we've allowed the darkness to start creeping back into our hearts and into our lives and into our minds. But every time that we refocus upon the light always causes that darkness to flee and we can be washed as white as snow. God pushes, in a sense, the reset button that says, now let's go again. We got some work to do here. Let's get with it. Let's get busy about our Father's business. Amen? And that's good news, is it not? In Isaiah 43, I want to share with you a few passages of Scripture in kind of bringing this plane in for landing a little bit, right? And I want you to listen to something because I want to say this up front so that there's no misunderstanding as we read it. Or as we read it. Ask yourself a simple question this morning, wherever you are, here in person or online. If you are a born-again believer, are you a descendant of Israel? I see confused looks in a lot of people's faces. Through Israel, the Messiah came. Through Israel, the Word of God came. Through Israel, the testimony and the witness to God came to the world. We owe everything to Israel. We owe everything to God choosing these people as his own and pouring himself into them. Though they messed up, we still owe everything to them because through them, the Messiah came. Jesus came through the nation of Israel. Amen? And so we are descendants of Israel. Now, here in the book of Isaiah, chapters 42, 3, and 4, God is speaking specifically to the nation of Israel at this time. But he's talking to them about when they're going to return to the land after their Babylonian captivity and how they're going to rebuild everything, as we covered through the book of Nehemiah. But I want you to hear him talking to you this morning as a descendant of Israel, because here's the thing. All throughout the Word of God and all throughout the world today, I have conversations with people about the rapture of the church and about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and everybody will make this excuse. You can't find the rapture anywhere in the Bible. Yes, you can. You can find it in chapter 43 of the book of Isaiah. Listen with all of your heart as God speaks his words into your heart this morning. But now, thus says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Did God prove that these things were true? When Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego walked through the fire, they didn't get burned. Amen? It was a picture to you and I of the faithfulness of God in keeping his promises. When they passed through the waters of the Red Sea, they did not drown. Right? When they took possession of the promised land, God fought for them. Amen? God's promises have always been true, they always will be true, and they will never fail. And he gives this mark upon it. I am the Lord your God. I am the Holy One of Israel, and I'm your Savior. I gave Egypt for your ransom, Ethiopia and Seba in your place, and since you were precious in my sight, you have been honored, and I have loved you. Therefore, I will give men for you and people for your life. And all throughout the history of Israel's existence, God did that very thing. He gave up Cush, he gave up Persia, he gave up Babylon, he gave up Rome, and every other empire that raised itself up in the world. God gave them up to preserve his people, Israel. Amen? And he's not going to do anything less for you and I. He'll give up the world for you and I who are his because we've invited him into our hearts to be our Savior and Lord. He is the holy and almighty God, and this world stands not a chance against him. For he will eradicate all darkness, and he will bring all of his purposes and all of his promises to pass, just as he has done throughout the history of the world. Listen with all of your heart. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your descendants from the east, and I will gather you from the west. And I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not keep them back. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I have created for my glory, saith the Lord. I have formed him, and yes, I have made him. Now, what is he promising to you and I? That just as he gathered the nation of Israel from the east and the west and the north and the south, and he returned them to the land under Ezra and under Nehemiah, and then now in our day and age, ever since 1948, he has returned Israel to the land, and they have taken possession of their land so that God could prove that his faithfulness to his promises never fails. He has promised to take his church away and to save them and spare them from the wrath which is to come. And he will gather us from the north and from the south and from the east and the west, just as he promised to the nation of Israel, because we are descendants of Israel, and the promise is just as much to his descendants as it was to Israel itself. God will keep his promises. Amen. Man, we ought to be jumping up and down and shouting for joy this morning, because there's nothing like that promise. And there's nothing like our God, who is the only one who's able to keep that promise. This is a celebration, folks. This isn't a hard message today. This celebrate the goodness of God. Celebrate the power of God, and celebrate the deliverance of God through the promises of his holy word. Amen. Bring out the blind people who have eyes and the deaf who have ears, and let all nations be gathered together. And let the people be assembled who among them can declare this and show us the former things. Let them bring out their witnesses, and that they may be justified, or let them hear and say, it is truth. You are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe in me and understand that I am he. He's talking about Israel here. Israel was his witness to the world, but guess what? Now the church is his witness to the world. The church is the very body that God is reaching out through the gospel to the whole world to bring them into his salvation and to spare them from the wrath which is to come. You are my witness, says the Lord, my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe in me and understand that I am he. For before me, there's no other God that was formed, nor shall there be after me. I, even I, am the Lord. And beside me there is no Savior, and I have declared and saved, and I have proclaimed. And there was no foreign God among you. Therefore you are my witnesses, says the Lord, that I am God. Indeed, before the day was, I am he. And there is no one who can deliver out of my hand. I work, and who will reverse it? Thus saith the Lord your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. For your sake I will send to Babylon, and I will bring them down as fugitives, the Chaldeans who rejoice in their ships. I am the Lord your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. What is he saying? Just as he destroyed the ancient nation of Babylon, he will also destroy the present nation of Babylon, just as he has already done in the past, and he will deliver you and I from their hands, just as he did the nation of Israel. Rejoice in the Lord and in the power of his mighty arm as he delivers you and I, as he has promised, and as he's already kept that promise throughout the physical nation of Israel, as a picture to you and I that we can trust that his promises will never fail, just as we sang. Amen. Isn't that good news?
Amen.
I want to wrap up with something real quick here, as we've got just a couple of minutes left. And you don't have to necessarily bring this up, but you can if you want to. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. Because I want you to see how the Lord wants this to affect your thought life and the way that you live each and every day. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are noble, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything that is praiseworthy, then meditate on these things. The things which you learned and you received and you heard and you saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. Do you hear what he's saying? Let he who has an ear to hear this morning hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. God says, I promise. And when you focus upon my promise and don't let anything else distract you from my promise, I'll keep you in perfect peace. The world can go crazy in a handbasket, but if you focus upon my promise and the one who promised it, I'll keep you in perfect peace. Let your mind be stayed upon the Lord God Almighty and not upon the things of the world. Amen? Now that's something to celebrate, isn't it? That's something to go running out of here about, running up and down the aisles, dancing in the aisles, and everything else that we can do, because he is a good God. Amen? Let's close. Father, thank you for your word this morning. Thank you most of all for the promises and how faithful that you are in keeping those promises. God, we admit this morning that we've allowed our hearts to be filled with anxiety over the current condition of the world, worried about this COVID, and naturally so. People are dying. People are getting infected at alarming rates. And yet, you're still in charge, and your promise is still true. So let us focus upon you, Lord, so that our hearts not be filled with anxiety. Let us rejoice and celebrate your faithfulness in keeping every single one of your promises, because all of them are yes and our amen through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank you so much for your love, your grace, and your mercy. I know that the age of grace is about to close. I know that your return is very, very near, and that you are trying with every fiber of your being to wake us all up and to get us focused upon your promises. So my prayer for everyone who's here right now, listening online or here in person, that right now that your words would convict and convince and empower and transform and do all of the things that only your word can do. Keep your promise to make each and every one of us new creations in Christ Jesus right here today, as people realize who they are and where they are, and they surrender their lives to you. And then may you be honored and may you be glorified through their lives as they focus upon your promises every step along the way to become all that you meant for them to be in Jesus Christ our Lord. And Father, we'll be careful. We'll be so careful to give all of the honor, all of the honor and the glory and the power to you and to the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Amen.
We've got one more song for you. As this COVID has kind of come and we've all adapted, this is normally our offering time, but we don't pass the plate because of the chance of the virus. So if you feel like you like God is calling you to give to the church, there's an offering jar on the back table, or you can donate through the website through text, which we will have on the screen next week, or the Faith Teams app. Please stand and sing along.
Jesus.
let's take a little extra time Thursday, as we're going to be full of family time and full of turkey and full of all those things that some of us like to do and don't necessarily need to do. But take some extra time to spend with God, more than we normally do, and just thank Him for that promise that He has given to us. Let's close in prayer. Lord, we're just so thankful for everything that You do, and that's why this week exists. That's why Thursday exists. You've set it aside so that we can spend that extra time with You and let You know what You already know. And we're so appreciative. We couldn't have done it without You. You are the reason why we are able to be saved. It's Your care and Your love for us. We just thank You, and we ask that You be with us as we go forward from here. Bless our week and be with us through the week so that we can do the will that You have for us this week, as Your will is much greater than ours. In Jesus' name we ask this.
Thank you, everyone, for coming this morning. Drive careful on your way home, and you are dismissed.
Yes,
Helen Shaneman, I would like to speak with you.
That boy hasn't got one yet either. Well, the wind's been ridiculous in that.
I know Santa.